He's finally done it. Actually, truly done it for real this time. Hideaki Anno has ended Evangelion. He couldn't do it with the end of Evangelion, not to be confused with the ending of Evangelion, which didn't stick even harder, but the third time, if you don't count video games, manga, and pachinko machines, as they say, is the charm. Evangelion 3.0 plus 1.01, Thrice Upon a Time, after going through exactly the kind of development hell all those version numbers so ominously suggest, has finally come out the other side as a truly definitive conclusion to the series that started the surreal robot subgenre and also redefined all modern anime all those years ago. Merchandising opportunities being what they are, that end may not stay the end. Anno's already raised the possibility of an interquel showing what happened to the world in the 14 years between 2.0 and 3.0, but that's probably for other animators to handle. He seems to be well and truly done with it, and I couldn't be more happy for him. Now, you may be confused as to what's so dang hard about ending an Evangelion. It's a big, bloody, horny robot fight thing, right? So just do the biggest, bloodiest, horniest robot fight you can do and you're set. That is somewhat true, and Thrice Upon a Time gets the obligation out of the way right away with a massive battle between Mari and an army of mass production Evas in post-impact Paris, which culminates in her using the Eiffel fucking tower as a drill that will pierce, if not the heavens, then at least one big evil robot's gun face. And of course, it just keeps on escalating from there. After spending an hour relaxing in the countryside, that is. Don't worry about getting bored, though, as not only is that segment packed with character growth and awash with supernatural and natural beauty, it's also got plenty of anime booty. In fact, I don't think a single minute of this film goes by without at least a few frames of gynaxing. Also, it significantly expands the series' lore. But there is another key component to Evangelion's identity. Cavernously deep introspection into the otaku condition, depression, and escapism as a coping mechanism. And tying both threads together in a truly conclusive, cohesive manner is tricky, to say the least. To fully understand the ends of Eva, one must start at the beginning of Eva, which isn't actually the beginning of Neon Genesis Evangelion, but rather the approximate midpoint of an entirely different Anno anime, episode 23 of Nadia, The Secret of Blue Water. Developed from a Jules Verne-inspired concept initially pitched to NHK by Hayao Miyazaki himself early in his own career, Nadia was a prestige project whose critical acclaim and ratings success helped to put Gainax on the map. But at the same time, it was also a behind-the-scenes catastrophe that could have easily put the entire studio 20,000 leagues under. Production wrapped with Gainax 80 million yen in the hole and without any IP rights to make up the difference, save for a license to publish a video game, which actually turned out pretty well for them. Still, it was a stressful, bootstrappy time for the studio, and the man who felt that stress the hardest was Anno himself, who, feeling overwhelmed, ended up stepping away from production midway through at episode 23 to focus on the 4-episode finale, which was fantastic. However, that left the middle stretch of episodes to be overseen by Shinji Iguchi, which resulted in a whole lot of meandering go-nowhere bullshit on a desert island, 2 pointless episodes set in Africa, which are even worse than you'd expect from an 80s anime, and a clip show. Anno wasn't happy with how it all turned out, and the feeling that he'd failed himself and his friends in a major way was only compounded after Gainax took a big advance on a Nadia movie that he couldn't even bring out of pre-production on account of how he was spiraling into 4 long years of depression. However, he would eventually turn his experience fighting that battle into the basis for this medium redefining masterpiece. In 1995, Neon Genesis Evangelion was like no other mecha series on the market, combining the technical specificity of Gundam-style real robots with the fantastical powers and stakes of the super robot genre that series had supplanted, using a layer of twisted psychological horror as the glue between the two. The lore was intensely dense, which made the otaku watching very happy, and what made them even happier was the anime's brutally beautiful mech on genocidal alien biomachine action. Also, the plug suits. I don't think I have to explain what nerds liked about the plug suits. Hideaki Anno was a lifelong otaku who both knew what those like him wanted to see and had the killer taste and artistic talent to actually realize and satisfy that desire in a truly novel, groundbreaking manner. But that's not all that makes Eva special. It uses that insanely anime-cool setting and the boldly defined broken characters with whom it's populated as a lens to explore Anno's own inner world in a powerfully personal way. It's not a big brain take to say that Shinji represents his otaku inclination toward escapism, Asuka his artistic talent and drive for validation, and Rei his essential childlike curiosity and desire for human connection. That subtext is so loud that it's basically text, literally text in the last two episodes, and to some extent the whole cast represents parts of Anno, most of them remnants in his heart of those he's known in real life, which allows basically every fight and conversation in the series to take on a clear double meaning as part of both the ongoing conflict to save humanity from itself and Anno's own inner battle to save himself from himself. A battle in which his otakudom doesn't seem to have helped much. Shinji's defining characteristic is a total inability to deal with stress and responsibility, which he further avoids dealing with by plugging in his headphones and shutting himself off from the world. When things reach a breaking point, he will usually throw himself into his Eva and go out to fight, but doing this doesn't actually resolve anything for him, or the world for that matter. It just solves the immediate problem at hand while giving us some cool explosions and laser beams to enjoy. Eventually, even Shinji getting in the robot starts to do more harm than good, because his real problem is a deep-seated fear of human connection, and the possibility of rejection that comes with it. And as those connections, the anime posits, are the foundation of human understanding of reality, neglecting them, whether it's to escape into a world of pure fantasy, or to lose yourself in work that you believe gives your real-life value, all but inevitably leads to disaster. These self-destructive impulses are born from Shinji's even deeper-seated hatred of himself, and a conviction that no one else could ever possibly love or even like him, even when it's apparent that most of the people around him actually do. There is a parent with whom it's not apparent, which fucks him up something fierce, but the deep irony in that relationship, or lack thereof, with Gendo, is that his dad is exactly the same way, pushing Shinji away out of fear that his son will see his true self and hate it the same way he does. Gendo, being an adult, comes up with a naturally more adult solution to this dilemma: sex. Sorry, instrumentality, a total synchronization of the barriers between all human hearts, which allows them to fuse into a single macro organism capable of attaining godhood. But like, the metaphysical embodiment of that lore concept is a giant Adam and Eve fused at the hips. End of Evangelion is a lot of things, but subtle isn't one of them. Instrumentality is perhaps best understood as that feeling of oblivion and complete union with another that accompanies orgasm, only stretching on for eternity and out around the entire world. Another way of understanding instrumentality is that it's kinda like going on the internet without today's sponsor, ExpressVPN, which protects you by creating a virtual AT field between your personal browsing data and hackers, websites, ISPs, and other online snoops. But that's not all it does. By encrypting your data and routing it through one of their high-speed servers in 94 different countries, ExpressVPN lets you mask your location and use the web like you live there. They even have one in Tokyo too, but not Tokyo 3, so don't get any funny ideas about using it for nerve access. What ExpressVPN's location masking tech can do, besides help you stay anonymous as you're gaming, torrenting, or perusing using pictures of partially nude coma patients, Shinji, is allow you to access streaming anime and other content that's restricted in your region. So if you're American, all you need to do is set your location to Canada to enjoy all the collected works of Anno's mentor Miyazaki on Netflix. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. ExpressVPN is a powerful, versatile tool that makes the whole internet more open and safer. To see for yourself what ExpressVPN can do for you and find out how to get 3 months of service free, head to expressvpn.com/basement or click the link in the doobly-doo today. Don't let your web browsing trigger the third and or fourth impact is, I guess, the logical conclusion of this half-baked ad segue. The sex thing is definitely closer to Anno's intent, though. I mean, there is a reason that one of the scenes which kicks off both the show and the film's versions of instrumentality is that one time Misato and Kaji shacked up and ignored their lives for an entire week, which, it should be noted, didn't make either of them happy in the long term. In fact, that closeness only scared Misato further away. Throughout the events of the anime, Kaji is perhaps the most stable and fulfilled adult in Shinji's orbit, and he is also a shameless womanizer, but that's a cover. In truth, his happiness comes from tending to his watermelon garden and to the people who need him most. Eva has a reputation for being complicated and hard to pin down, and that's certainly true of its pseudo-religious, endless spin-off spanning metaphysifictional lore, but the message at its core is actually pretty simple, and has stayed consistent since the first ending. Try to love yourself, then go outside and talk to other people, you fucking nerds. It'll be good for you, I promise. That doesn't mean you have to abandon your nerdy passions. Haruhi knows Anno never lost his love for anime titties, giant robots, and giant anime titties, but rather that you'll never escape your problems by using those things as a substitute for real life. Conversely, when media is enjoyed and created in the full context of the real world, fantasy and reality can enrich each other in turn. One consistently positive point in Eva's outlook on otaku is that our imaginations, when properly applied, allow us to envision worlds better than ones where bloated armies run by selfish old men can ruin everything for everyone. Though it is careful to remind us that actually getting there takes a lot of real-world work. The show's original ending made a bold artistic choice to forgo all anime violence and most fanservice-y indulgences in favor of a focus on Shinji thinking through these issues and talking them through with the people closest to him. I'll defend those two episodes to the death for their avant-garde direction, the deeply resonant way in which they reflect and expand on the show's central themes, and the frankly genius manner in which the mental world conceit is used to justify the copious asset reuse and still image work necessitated by poor scheduling and/or budget issues on the anime, but at the same time, I won't deny that it leaves a lot to be desired. Evangelion is a show about giant fighting robots, after all, and while it may be narratively justified to end it with a little more conversation and a lot less action, it's all but impossible to make that narratively satisfying for people who were sold on the initial premise. Many fans of Eva at the time were not fans of Eva's ending, and otaku being otaku, they weren't quiet about it either. There's an infamous 40 kilobyte text doc that did the rounds on the Japanese internet in February of 1997, which attempts to explain the ending's issues from the perspective of a self-proclaimed anonymous industry insider, while personally insulting Anno in every other paragraph. In time, more and more people have learned to appreciate the TV ending for what it does well, but without a movie that actually satisfied those base nerd needs, it's unlikely that many fans would have come around on it at all. End of Evangelion is everything the show's ending wasn't. Bombastic, operatic action with some of the coolest animation and most brutal violence in the entire medium, with plenty of anime titties, the biggest ever, and an end of the world every bit as visually spectacular and emotionally devastating as anyone could possibly want, if not more so. At the same time, it's hard to ignore how angry a film it is, especially at Shinji, whose depiction as otaku audience surrogate is about as unflattering as it possibly could be. As much ink has been spilled over what a coma creeper he is in the opening scene as there is fluid spilled in that scene, and from there he just passively fails his way from one scene to the next, getting two fan-favorite waifus killed as they try to drag him into the goddamn robot, before almost immediately killing everyone else once he does finally get in. Right after instrumentality commences, remember what that's a metaphor for, he's shown as an Oedipal toddler mindlessly caressing, then senselessly beating the shit out of, a very suggestively placed sandcastle. Then, in contrast to the show's school rom-com alternate reality where Asuka's his flirty childhood friend, the film has him violently turn their kitchen over in a domestic dispute, then choke her out for refusing to accept his obviously empty proclamations of love, all because he's too caught up in the fantasy to recognize his own self-deception. From there, we move on to a montage of beautiful live-action scenery intercut with shots of a crowded theater in a pointed effort to make the audience aware of the reality around them, which ends with a flash cut of fan letters and death threats that were sent to Gainax and spray-painted on its offices in the years since the show ended. And to wrap it all up, after rejecting instrumentality and restoring humanity's individuality, Shinji wakes up next to Asuka on the beach and immediately proves that he's learned nothing by choking her out again before collapsing into a sobbing heap on her chest. Kimochi warui, indeed. Only Anno could tell us for sure why it ended up this way. The original ending of Eva was positive, deeply personal, and intended to be uplifting, so it would be understandable if he was frustrated with fans who rejected it and sent him death threats, but whatever the reason, the way End of Evangelion quadruples down on depicting Shinji as despicable ends up complicating, if not outright contradicting, the show's message. When even the cameraman hates Shinji, how is he ever supposed to love himself? Then again, maybe that's the point. It was simple enough for Anno to say, love yourself and leave the house after jumping right out of a depressive spiral and into making one of the most successful and influential TV original anime ever. Perhaps facing fan backlash challenged his newfound positive outlook, reminded him that depression is a lifelong battle, and led him to create a more challenging and open-ended exploration of the same fundamental themes from a darker, more cautionary angle. Regardless, it's clear that End of Evangelion was a quick reaction, not a considered response, to the original show's reception and perceived shortcomings. No doubt, with a bit of time and a bigger budget afforded by the franchise's prestige, Anno could deliver a much more satisfying and thoughtful encapsulation of everything he wanted to say with Eva. Time he would get, and along with it, even more to say. The rebuild of Evangelion Film Project was first conceived in 2002, started in earnest in 2006, and bore its first fruit, a faithful cinematic recreation of the show's first few angel fights, in 2007. It would take two more years after that to make the second film, which substantially revised the next set of angel battles to introduce a new character and build up to a much earlier third impact. 3 years after that, we'd see that new story continue, still hitting important plot beats from the original anime, but doing so on a ruined Earth 14 years later. If you're decent at math, you may have noticed that it's been nearly that many years between then, 2012, and now, and there are a lot of reasons for that. The stressful production of 3.0 triggered another long bout of depression for Anno, in which he was barely able to visit his own studio more than a few times a year. In that time, he was productive, working on Miyazaki's The Wind Rises and directing one of the best live-action Godzilla films ever alongside Shinji Iguchi, but he didn't want to work on more Eva, and even when he did finally return to the project, he just didn't know how to go about finishing it. That led to dozens of rewrites before and even during production. So much time had passed that he could better see eye to eye with Gendo than Shinji. Still, he worked diligently to end Evangelion one last time, for the fans more than himself this time. And the long-awaited resulting film represents not only an autobiographical look at what he's been through in the last 20 years, but a much gentler, more nuanced expression of the core ideas expressed in the last two attempts. Though it is also more brutal in its own ways. As I said, after the big, dumb battle in Paris, which was an intentional effort to outdo the first few episodes of Nadia, the film settles into a near hour-long action-free aside where Shinji, Asuka, and a blank slate Rey clone wander out of the near-third impact wastes and into a tiny village that is all that remains of Tokyo 3. There, they find their old classmates, now grown up, married, with kids, jobs, and communal responsibilities, living the best lives they can, even in a broken world. And here's Shinji, still a child after 14 years spent huddled in his giant robot womb, like a neat shut-in at a high school reunion. His friends don't treat him that way, though. Toji, and especially Kensuke, are very understanding of what he's going through, offering him both kind words and plenty of space and time to sort his own feelings out. Time which the film uses to show, rather than tell us, how fulfilling time spent gardening and talking to people can be. Asuka does try her old tactic of abusing Shinji into action, in the process paying back what he gave her in the last ending and then some, but she's also still a child, albeit a slightly more mature one, dealing with her own depression-coded Lilim symptoms that render her unable to sleep. And in this film, that tactic doesn't work at all. Instead, it only pushes Shinji further into himself, where only the Rey clone, with her childlike innocence and simple, impossible-to-misinterpret kindness and affection, can reach him. It takes even her many visits between days spent frolicking in rice fields to break through his shell of self-pity and hatred, but eventually she does. He gets moving again, and it's not long before he starts taking Kensuke's kind words to heart and learning more about the village and the people who live there. He grows so much that by the time the Tang alarm rings on Rey's plug suit, not only can he go without her, unthinkable for any of his previous incarnations, but the loss actually helps him find the resolve to get back in the robot and finish the fight with nerve. Once aboard Misato's flagship, he's even able to show Asuka that he understands. I mean, really understands how he's hurt her in the past and why she was mad at him. Even before things go all giant Rey on us, he's begun to accept himself, faults and all, and feel the real love for others that comes with that acceptance. Which means that once instrumentality does kick off, after one last kick-ass battle against an infinite swarm of mass-production Evas, in which Asuka's at her absolute coolest, not as a lone wolf badass, but as part of a team with Mari, Shinji's ready to take the fight to his own father, who's used Unit 13 to make himself the catalyst in this version of the apocalypse. What follows is a truly incredible giant robot duel set in an imperceptible anti-universe at the boundary between fantasy and reality, which their minds resolve as Tokyo 3 in its prime. Or rather, as a tokusatsu set of Tokyo 3, complete with buildings that slide around like they're made of cardboard, and matte-painted walls that collapse out into a larger soundstage. This is a much more personal expression of Anno's present interest than the generic theater stage that represented Shinji's mind in previous Eva's projects, and also serves as a perfect transition to a world where the scale of the Evas has no real bearing on the fight, and they can battle in the show's old human-scale sets. It's all ultimately theater, though. There's no resolving this conflict through combat alone, as Evas 1 and 13, Shinji and Gendo, the spears of hope and despair, are all mirrors of each other. To resolve this, Shinji has to do the only thing that's ever scared him more than fighting an angel, and have a real heart-to-heart conversation with his dad. It takes some doing, and a lot of surprisingly heartbreaking Gendo backstory, But they do finally see each other's point of view and understand, after 25 years of near misses, that it was the same fundamental self-hatred and fear of rejection that kept them both from loving each other. And that helps Gendo to finally, actually, in a believable way, see the error of his ways. This exchange alone, I think, would make this the most satisfying and complete conclusion to Evangelion. Even in the TV show's happier ending, there's no real closure on their relationship. Here, anime's number one dad is actually able to redeem himself and reclaim his humanity by taking Shinji's place alongside his wife's spirit, which was trapped in the giant robot, in a sacrifice that destroys every last angel and Eva to create a new world that doesn't need any of them. In the interim, Shinji ends up back on that beach with Asuka, where instead of choking her, he can finally be honest both about his feelings for her and the fact that his crush, like hers, has long since faded. It's a proper adult conversation, one of many in this ending, that helps Shinji mature even further, so that even after a gorgeous girl with massive boobs comes crashing into the fiction zone with her giant robot to save him, it feels properly earned and believable to see Shinji as an adult waiting on a stunningly realistic train platform for his gorgeous girlfriend with massive boobs, and then flirting with her in an us proper adults are gonna go home and bone now sort of way that, despite the fact that they're both wearing full suits, feels more authentically erotic than 1,000 butt cuts of jiggly plug suits put together. Yuko Miyamura, Asuka's voice actress, who purportedly had the roughest time of just about anyone working on the original show and movie, remarked toward the end of this production that Anno-san is amazing. He's become an adult. And this is an ending to Evangelion that only an adult Anno, a director with copious experience in both film and animation, a man who's lived enough to fully understand not just Shinji's struggles, but those of all the grown-ups who shape his world, and a doting husband who actually knows what it means to really love a woman, could conceive. An ending that gives the fans all the action they could ever want, substantially expands the series' lore, and most importantly, actually shows us how going outside, learning about nature, and talking to other people can help us heal instead of just telling us about it in a big dark theater. Now, Eva fans being Eva fans, I'm sure a lot of people will still be very unhappy with it, but for this Eva fan, at least, it was more than worth the wait. I'm Geoff Thew, professional anime essayist, signing out from the office in the house that I'm renting.